This month, we want to welcome Doug Sneed and Nelson Schuman. If I met him today, thank you for coming. Doug, I've known for many, many years, and appreciate his ministry and what God's using him in the ministry. We appreciate all that God's working through the body of Christ. And he knows that not only is he working through us, but he's working on us.
Amen.
Lord. But we're going to turn it over to Doug here just a minute. We're going to worship some. That means we're ready to worship God.
Amen.
Worship Jesus. All right. I want to share a scripture with you. The Lord has laid on my heart. It's in the book of Acts. It's a very familiar scripture. It's Acts chapter 1. It says, now Peter and John went up together into the temple at the hour of prayer, being about the ninth hour. A certain man lay from his mother's womb, carried him. They had laid down at the gate of the temple, which is called Beautiful, to ask alms of them that entered into the temple. Who seeing Peter and John about going into the temple, asking an alms. Peter, fastening his eyes upon him with John, and looked on us. He said, look on us. And he gave heed to them. Here it is. Expecting to receive something of them. How many of you come here tonight to expecting from God?
Amen.
All right? Everybody's got a need. Amen? One of the keys to receive from God is you've got to have an expectation that God is going to meet with you here tonight. Praise God. Another scripture says we got to do what? Hunger and thirst after righteousness. And then you shall be filled. So there's a part that we play in faith manifesting itself. Where healing, deliverance, and freedom is set free. There's a part that you and I have to play. And that part is we have to expect that God will honor his word. I mean, understand God will honor his word. Right? Every God, every tittle, every part of God's word, he will honor his word. What he said, he will do. He's not a man that he shall lie. Neither is he a man that he will repent. For what God has said, shall he not certainly bring it to pass. Right?
Amen.
So we have to be expecting. Praise God. We have to have an expectation. Now, when I first heard about Brother Nelson, I don't know about you, but I'm a part of that church that just embraces miracles, signs, and wonders. Praise God, aren't you?
Amen.
Praise God. Much of the church has rejected that. They really have. Say it to shame them. I don't say it to bring condemnation. I just say it to them. Listen, why not?
Amen.
Why not believe?
Yeah.
If thou canst believe, all things. Everybody say all things.
All things.
Are possible. Praise God. All right. So I'll leave you with that. Praise the Lord. Y'all ready to praise the Lord?
Yes.
All right. Let's stand at our feet. Let's pray that first song. Praise God. And let's just put our hearts toward the Lord. Begin to worship God. Thank you, Lord. I mean, those you can do it. Praise God. Go ahead, Bob.
Thank you.
Pastor Gerald, his wife Kim. Most of this is for Kim. Been good friend for a number of years. If you don't know him, I'll share something about him. Because I'm proud to call him my friend, that he's served over 30 years at the Jacksonville Sheriff's Office. And is a chaplain for both the ACC, the Fraternal Order of Police, and the Spiritual Advisor to our sheriff. And I'm knowing the man and the character of the man. I'm glad that law enforcement in our county receives the sort of spiritual guidance that he's able to provide. We thank you for that, brother. It's an honor anytime we're invited to someone's house. It's an honor and a privilege. We do acknowledge your authority in the house tonight, even though we're your ministry as guests. Don't want to take up too much time because I want to get Nelson. The pastor mentioned miracles, and about 2 years ago I started a journey. A couple of weeks ago, I was in a specialist's office. I was talking about how unusual the whole medical system had been with me over the last 2 weeks. How everything I've learned it wasn't normal. And he looked at me and he said, well, let me just be very honest with you. 2 years ago, when they sent me to you, you were done. At the most, you had 2 to 3 months to live, period. No if, ands, or buts about it. You were gone. When you got to me, they already told me, this man's not. He said, so the fact that you kept walking in the door, nobody planned for you to be alive. Nobody planned for anything to work. You didn't have answers. You were a dead man walking. And I share this with you because there may be to give glory to the Lord first and foremost for what he's done for me. But if you need a miracle tonight, there's a living testimony, the power of the testimony. And it's not been an easy journey. But he said, you know, they haven't known how to respond to me because you keep breaking all the expectations. But that's God's breaking expectations. And here's this doctor, and he said, well, it's a miracle. Doctors don't like that word. And he said, and you have an assignment from God. And I said, that's why you're my favorite doctor. Because a lot of the doctors that believe in miracles and wars and acknowledge God. Also, a little over 2 years ago, probably 2.5, Larry Nelson's ministry, you ought to know him. We spent a lot of time together, and about a year ago we spent a good bit of time together. And in our healing rooms at the River House, we've incorporated the restorative freedom teaching, and it's been powerful in terms of the impact that it's had on both physical and emotional healing, their healing. And it's become a very good part of what they do, but also restorative freedom deliverance center. So after tonight, if you want more ministry, you can get in touch with Jenna. Hey, way Jenna. That's my right and my left hand back there. And we can set up some further ministry for you. But this is a powerful ministry of setting people free. You know, Jesus quotes Isaiah, he said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, proclaim liberty to the captive and freedom to the prisoner. Now, we all know what happens. Pastor Gerald wrestled by you in prison. You've been in prison for things that you've done. Fellas, you don't pay your taxes, they don't send you to prison. You commit a crime, you go to prison. Sin has a consequence. But I believe that most believers that I've met have experienced forms of captivity. You're taken captive. Not by anything that you're kidnapped, so to speak, particularly when you're younger. And a lot of what this ministry is about is about freeing people from places of captivity. When you continue to go around the mountain, you can't kind of quite get over or get through or get around something. It's the same thing as the tiger facing the cage. And if I go outside and they kidnap me, well, hopefully the SWAT team has to come in and rescue me, right? You find yourself in a place you don't want to be. You don't know how you got there, you don't want to be there, and you can't find your way out. And Jesus is the captive freedom. And Nelson's ministry is about releasing and freeing the captive. So I'm going to, if you would, welcome him, Nelson. And I'm glad to have you with us again this year. I appreciate your ministry, my brother. And look forward to being free. You know, no matter where you're at, no matter what you're going through, I find my own life is always a little something somewhere. And I can be more free, more free, and more free. Amen.
Yeah. Good.
Welcome, Nelson.
Is this working? Can you hear me? Or will follow both of that? I can always, yeah, I'll go to the lab. Well, there you go.
Okay. Can I hold for a couple seconds?
Okay.
Should it turn on?
It turned on. Now you can hear me. All right. So, I always like to take a poll quickly before we start. So, who here has heard about me maybe longer than a month ago? Who here? Okay. Who here has heard me in the last 3 weeks? Okay. So, it's maybe 40% in the last 3 weeks and maybe 60% longer than that. So, I never wanted to do ministry in my entire life. Ever. I grew up in Indiana. It was a farm kid. I say my kid from a cornfield. 160 acre farm. We had pigs, we had cattle, I was in 4-H. I was in FFA, Future Farmers of America. I did not want to be a farmer either. I grew up on the farm. I worked really hard. I appreciated hard work and hard labor. And I'm like, I don't want to do that anymore. So I went to Purdue University, you know, Purdue Big Ten school. They're playing football, finally, in the Big Ten. Oh my gosh, I'm a huge football fan, so. You guys play football in Florida? It's too hot to play. I was driving, I'm like, oh my gosh, how do you play football when it's 95 degrees? Like, you lose 10 pounds by playing one game. It's so hot. Went to Purdue, got a sales and marketing job because I found out that I'd like to talk. And in fact, if I could just find a job where I could get paid to talk, then that's what I would do. And so I became a sales person for the largest compliance company in the United States called Banker Systems. So basically when you have banks, they need to comply with state laws and federal laws. And we provided forms, loan processing forms, and opening up new accounts. And I was a software sales rep, so I did software demonstrations. I actually became the top sales rep in the country. I was like, oh my gosh, this is amazing. Because what I observed when I was growing up, in fact, I'll say this, so my mom and dad, when I was a little kid, we went to a Church of God. And this reminds me a lot of the Church of God in Columbia City, Indiana. You know of a lady named Mariah Woodruff Eder? She was like one of the most anointed women in United States history back in the late 1800s, early 1900s. She was from Ohio, and the Lord told her to start doing miracles, healings, and stuff. And she didn't want to do that. And then where did she actually start that at? It was actually in Columbia City, Indiana. It was actually the Church of God that, now it's a different Church of God. They moved, but that building's still there. But she was ordained under that Church of God, and she actually did the ministry there for 3 weeks and saw tons of healing. So she actually is buried in Indianapolis now. But anyway, my mom played the piano, played the organ, and I grew up in a normal, I'll say normal. We all have different normals. I've learned that with ministry. We all have different normals. Some normals are really bad, and some normals are great, but most are not so good. You know, you're fortunate to have one parent that loved you, and you're super fortunate you have two, because most don't even have one. And you think about the divorce rate in the church, it's like 50%. So, and I observed all these things. I observed, like, in my family that my mom and dad, they didn't have much money. We grew up on a farm. And they would have arguments over money. So what that told me is, okay, find a job where you can make a lot of money and you won't have any problems, right?
Right.
People that are wealthy don't have any problems. They're all happy. They're all peaceful. It's amazing. They all go to heaven. Oh, my gosh. It's so great. And it's funny, I've been to Hollywood a couple times, and I've worked with some people from Hollywood, some actors, actresses, and people that are athletes, professional athletes, people that are millionaires, billionaires. It's just blowing my mind what God's having me do, because I never had a desire to do this. But I went through experiences, and I've learned that experiences are the best teacher, even though they're painful. There's always purpose in the pain. And when we go through things in a family that hurt us, what happens to us? So I went through, and I'm not going to go through all my testimony, but I went through a series of events where I was able to observe a person who was hurt really, really deeply from their father and their mother, and it affected them. They were not a very happy person, and they would tend to be controlling, want their way a lot, and get mad, and get angry, and trigger, and become a different person. And if you didn't give them their way, they would just get really mad, and get madder. So you'd have to condition them to learn, okay, if I keep giving them their way, they won't be as mad. But they never got happy. And it was like they were mad if you were happy. So it's like, what is going on? And I didn't know the spiritual stuff because I was told that, okay, you grow up in church, you'll leave, okay, the demons all leave when you say, Jesus, come into my heart, they're gone, can't affect you anymore. Even though Paul kind of wrote in the Bible that we're supposed to take every thought captive, why would he do that? I don't know. I mean, if you're a Christian, the demons are gone. You don't have any problems. You don't hear any thoughts from the enemy. Of course not. They had to leave. But then I started observing everybody in church that would be angry and lie about people and gossip and have marriages that were a mess and their children ended up becoming, you know, not happy and they were hurt. And I was observing this. And then when I went through some things, then the Lord was showing me and teaching me some things, preparing me for ministry. I didn't know. I didn't want ministry. My grandmother, she wanted somebody to be like a pastor in the family. I'm like, well, that's not going to be me. I go, I will not do anything in ministry. I just want to make money. If you make a lot of money, you can buy your way out of problems, you know? So I got a job, made a lot of money, but then life happened and some things that were out of my control, things that I even did that I'm like, what? I'm not behaving very Christian-like. Why is that? You know, why is my son not behaving Christian-like? Why is my wife? I don't understand. These are supposed to be Christians. Christians are supposed to be happy all the time, have joy, laughter, and fun. And the fruit of the Spirit. We're supposed to have actually love, like unconditional love, and kindness, and goodness, and gentleness, and faithfulness, and self-control, not controlling other people, which oftentimes I observed that people that would get hurt tend to control other people. I'm like, what is this? And so eventually I went through a series of unfortunate events. Oh, didn't they make a movie or a book called that? Series of Unfortunate Events?
Yeah.
I think they did. So ultimately, after I went through all this, then the Lord started to speak to me, started in my head, and I was thinking, what is that thought, you know? I didn't think that was possible. I never really paid attention to my thoughts, like most of us. We just have the thoughts. We think all of the thoughts are our own. We don't think some of the thoughts could be from the enemy, which, in many cases, most of the thoughts are coming from the enemy, causing us to make decisions that hurt us and hurt other people. We think that all of our thoughts are just our own, and they make sense. You know, and the thoughts of the enemy will cause us to control other people, demand our way, lie, do sexual things that are not godly, not be having the fruit of the Spirit. We have a lot of fruit of the flesh. And we see a lot of people out there in the world that operate with this fruit of the flesh, which is not peace. You know, I always say, how do you know when you've been, you know, healed from the past and delivered? Well, you're going to have a lot of peace in your thoughts, for one. You should have a whole bunch of tormenting thoughts. And if you pay attention to the thoughts, anything that comes in is going to be negative, causing you to believe that your spouse hates you for no reason. You just keep hearing those thoughts. And it causes you to want to strive, get mad at your child, blame your father for something, hate on your pastor, hate on your... Anybody ever hate on you? Anybody lie about you? I mean, all these things that are not godly. And so the Lord started showing me, he said, here's how it happens, Nelson. He said, from the time of conception, the enemy wants to hurt us, correct?
Sure.
Well, how does that happen? Well, let's say that your mom and your dad created you, and now you're in the womb, and maybe mom and dad have an argument. Maybe dad doesn't want the child. Maybe mom doesn't want the child. Do you think maybe the baby can feel that and sense that? Yeah, they can. And what happens at birth? If you are giving birth to a child, it's stressful enough, but there's some fear there that's already there. But what if some extra fear comes in? What happens if you get born prematurely? what happens if you have to go be a C-section instead of a regular birth? There's oftentimes fear that will flood in because the doctor's like, oh my gosh, this is very scary. So when that happens, fear will come in through the mother, through the umbilical cord, into the child. I've seen this time and time and time again when I've done sessions with people. And the child grows up and they have what they call anxiety and fear, which is nothing more than thoughts coming in from the enemy. And they can't stop it. And they oftentimes go to the doctors or psychologists, and then they prescribe medication and stuff. That doesn't take away the actual spiritual root of the issue. All it does is kind of try to manage a situation that is a spiritual situation. And so I started seeing all this and observing this, and I'm like, oh my gosh. I go, God, I think you're onto something. Because I'm like, I want to get to the spiritual root where a person can actually be free, like the guy that had Legion, who was a complete mess. And then he was back in his right mind, you know, instantly. I want to see those kind of things. And so what the Lord showed me is when we get hurt and we get wounded, we're going to hear negative thoughts that are going to remind us about all those wounds or traumas, oftentimes the rest of our life, if we don't forget. How many times do you remember all the negative things that happened to you and you listen to it every day? Because the enemy keeps bringing it back. You know, you remember when you were 8 years old and your dad did this to you, or your mom did that to you, and you keep thinking it, and you keep thinking it, and you keep thinking it. Well, a lot of those thoughts are being prompted by the enemy. If they have legal rights, and I'll talk about that, because the enemy and the Lord, they set this up in a way where there are legal reasons why the enemy would have the ability to speak to us and torment our thoughts. And one of the things is we get wounded. We get hurt. And what happens when we get hurt or have injustices done to us? Oftentimes we get angry, don't we? We're like, oh my gosh, I shouldn't have done that. And then we'll get thoughts up here a lot, telling us, you know what? They did you wrong. And you should pay them back. You should expose them. You should go on Facebook and just let them have it. You know, or call all their friends and tell them all these evil things that they did. And what does that do? You know, I think the Bible says vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. It doesn't say vengeance is yours. Have at them and go after them and try and tear them down. No. So we get a lot of anger and bitterness for the things that people have done for us. And all it does is torment us. It's like we're drinking the poison hoping that they die because we're mad and angry with them. So when we forgive, we basically are giving them to the Lord, saying, hey Lord, here, you take them. I forgive them. What did Jesus say when he was dying, by the way? The last words he said before that, Father, forgive them, and know not what they do. He was our model. And it's hard sometimes when we have a father or mother or a sexual violation done to us, when we're an innocent little kid, especially like from age, well, birth, or in the womb until 10 years old, we can't really defend ourselves. So that's what the enemy wants to hurt us the most, because he knows, you know, how many times I've heard from testimonies saying, yeah, I had a man or a woman that touched me inappropriately, or I had a child step over at their house, they showed me some pornography, things like that. Well, all that stuff impacts us. You know, and that's why men oftentimes struggle with pornography, because they're showed that, like I was when I was like 5 years old. I was a kindergartner. I was innocent. I wasn't looking for that whatsoever. And I go to the bathroom, mind my own business, kindergarten, and then there's some boys in the corner saying, hey, Nelson, come take a look at this. I'm like, what? Little innocent, no, Nelson. Yeah. And then they're like, here, they show me a magazine, and they have naked women in it. I'm like, what is that? I'm like, I'm not supposed to look at naked women. Well, then that's all it takes, is one exposure to that will draw a person, causing them to be addicted to that, and they can't stop it. And if they're in the church and they're Christians, it's torment. Because they're like, I want to stop looking at this, and I can't. And I feel really guilty and ashamed, and I can't stop it. How many people do we know, you know, that struggle with that? Pastors that struggle with that. Things like that, the pastors struggle. And they feel horrible about it, and they don't want to behave that way. And how many times are we in marriages where we have one person that tends to want to reign more and gets more angry and controlling of the other, and they go off on that person to get their way? Well, that doesn't make for a lot of close intimacy in their relationship, does it? No, it makes it miserable. And there's a whole lot of miserable marriages out there, people that attend church every Sunday and Wednesday, You're open on Wednesday, and you're miserable. You know, I know what it's like. I know what it's like to go through that. And so what will happen is when we get wounded, we'll get reminded of the stuff that happened to us. Oftentimes over and over and over and over and over, and we can't stop it. Why? Because there's people like the enemy has. We have not truly forgiven those people in our hearts that have hurt us. And the same thing could happen when you're born. If you're born prematurely and there's a lot of fear going on, you will grow up and you will have anxiety and you will have fear, and you can go to as many psychologists as you want, psychiatrists, they can't fix it. In fact, I have done sessions with psychologists, with psychiatrists, with judges, with very wealthy people, with athletes that are tormented by these thoughts. They can't turn them off, they can't stop. When they've gone through the sessions that we have, they'll tell me. Some of them will instantly get free from that. Oftentimes it's a process as we forgive and truly forgive. We have to truly forgive in our hearts. We can say that we forgive in our mouth, but if in our hearts we still have anger and hatred for the people that did us wrong, we've not forgiven them. And the enemy's got me right, and we'll continue to get tormented. And oftentimes we bring in sickness, we bring in infirmities and stuff. I know that Billy Graham once said that he believed 75% of the people that were in the hospitals wouldn't be there if they would just forgive.
Right.
I think that's true. You know, so I had to learn myself. I had to go through some stuff later in life. My mom and my dad really didn't get the pain from, but later when I got married, I had some pain to go through. And I had to learn that I had to forgive. And what was interesting is the Lord showed me my wife from his perspective, so that I could see, okay, she was a hurting little girl, but she grew up with pain from her dad and from her mom and from a sexual violation that happened. And she kept hearing the thoughts from her father over and over. And oftentimes she heard it in the tone and the anger that he had. You know, when he grew up, he was an orphan. He didn't know his dad, so he was hurt. And I started seeing the correlation, and I'm thinking, you know what, God, I think this is what the number one problem in the world is. The number one problem in marriage is we've not completely forgiven everybody that's hurt us. And when we get hurt, we get this that comes in, and it's called pride, P-R-I-D-E. And, of course, Lucifer was kicked out of heaven for his pride when he was like God. So we have to humble ourselves. You know, and I wouldn't have ever thought that I could see pride in my life, but I was prideful. You know, looking back, the Lord took me through a series of events that actually took away all my money. I was wanting to save up to become a millionaire. And the Lord, I actually went through a divorce and went through, couldn't control after 19 years. But the Lord said, what is it that you want out of your life? And I'm like, well, I thought it was money. I thought if I had $1 million, I wouldn't have any problems. But all I have is seemingly problems. So I guess I had to choose something. I would like to have peace. So I'm like, I don't have peace. You can't really buy peace. And so I'm like, if I could have both, I'd take peace and money. If I have to choose one, give me peace. And he said, okay, here's what I'll do. He said, I will take away all the money that you have so that you have to depend on me. And I'm going to change your heart. And in the process, when I do that, I will give you the peace that you're looking for. And then eventually, I will bring the money back. And it'll be way greater than it was before. But then you'll use it for kingdom purposes, for the souls of people. You ever heard the term soul? You ever wonder what that meant? Because when I was growing up, they always talked about in the church, souls, souls, souls. I'm like, is the soul here? And I'm like, where's the soul? Okay, I don't know. And nobody really ever talked about that. Well, the soul is comprised of our mind, which are thoughts coming in, our will, our free will to do things, and our emotions that we have. And what I've seen is when people have gone through getting healed through forgiveness, and through repentance for pride and for what we've done to hurt other people, then we take away legal rights so we can command the enemy to go, and then the thoughts that we get. You know how many thoughts a day that the average person has? This is crazy. I didn't think anybody did a study on this, but it was like over a year ago, the Lord's like, how many thoughts a day do the average person have? I don't know. Nobody knows that. You don't keep track of thoughts per day. He's like, well, Google it. You'll find out they did. I'm like, really? So I Googled it, and it came up, the National Science Foundation. They did a study, and they found that the average person could have 50 to 60,000 thoughts a day.
Wow.
I'm like, you're kidding me. And what was really blowing my mind is of those thoughts, the percentage of the thoughts that were negative were 80%. 80%. And the thoughts that we have are 95% the same thoughts we had the day before. And the day before. And the Lord said, that's demonic. That's the enemy speaking to them in their minds. And I'm like, you're serious. I mean, that makes sense. Because people come when they've gotten delivered, they're like, I don't have those thoughts anymore. Oh my gosh, I have peace. And they kept thinking it's going to come back. But they're like, well, it's not. Or if they do hear something, they can discern it now. And they can say, I'm not going to listen to that. That's a lie. And, you know, I'm not going to buy into that. Because the enemy wants to compound us by giving us thoughts to provoke us to sin and to do things that are evil. And then when we do, then he condemns us for it afterwards. We never win. You know, it causes us to take an offense, get angry at somebody. How many people have we seen in the world that take an offense at the drop of a hat? I mean, all the time. We're supposed to forgive. You know, I'm not seeing too many forgiving people in this world. I see a lot of taking offense at anything. And then they want to be angry and throw fits and go crazy on people. So what I've learned is that when we can get a word from the Lord to explain, why did this person treat me like this? Why did my dad, like, leave me? You know, a lot of times I see this from people, like, well, my dad didn't hurt me. He wasn't even in my life. I'm like, oh, that's kind of a wound.
Right.
You think? I'm like, yeah. I'm like, your dad's supposed to represent God. And if dad is not there, then how are you going to feel trusted to be protected by God? I'm like, oh, yeah, I never thought about that. Yeah, I end up getting married to these people that aren't very loving, and I don't have a good role model, and then I end up going through a divorce, and then I go remarry, and then I do the same thing again. And so, if we can see these people the way God sees them, he loves us all, even those who are really evil, did really bad things, because they were hurt. The only reason anyone does anything bad is because they were hurt as little kids growing up. And the enemy knows that. You know, there's people that get satanic ritually abused. Anybody ever heard of that? They call it SRA. They go through horrendous things, like rapes and horrible things, because the people know that if they can keep hurting them a whole bunch, they'll be really tormented. And then what happens is they have an alternate personality. And truth be told, a lot of us actually have an alternate personality. You ever see someone that you're married to, or maybe yourself, let's be honest, that we get triggered, we become a different person, maybe for an hour, or we get mad and angry, and we go off on somebody. That's like an alternate personality. That's not who you normally are. But if you get triggered because you've not been healed of a soul wound when you were 3 years old or 5 years old, then you can go blue in your face by saying, well, let's read a book that tells us that we should love more and respect more. Yeah, that's all great. But we can't do it because we're getting 50,000 thoughts a day telling us to be selfish and get angry. And so if you can't get the thoughts turned off, I don't care how many books you try to read. In fact, if you try to read the Bible, oftentimes you fall asleep. Truth be told, it's true. Just get the Bible out, and oftentimes it keeps you so you can't fall asleep. So you're like struggling with all these thoughts, tormenting at nighttime. You can't turn it off. You're like, might as well read the Bible. You read the Bible, then you fall asleep. And then it wakes you back up again. Oh my gosh, I'm not going to read the Bible again. And then you fall asleep again or read a Christian book. So to heal from the past, what we have to do is we have to forgive with our hearts. And the only way we can do that sometimes is to ask Jesus to give us a word about why did our dad or our mom or our friends or anyone, could be anybody in the church, why did they hurt us? Why did they lie about us? Why did they do these horrendous things? Well, let's get a word from the Lord and see what he says. Normally, he's going to tell you they were hurt. Then you better forgive them. You got to forgive them. Well, you don't have to. Maybe it's a free will. You can be angry all you want, but you're going to have more sickness and disease oftentimes. You know. And there's also another factor that I'll get into. It's called witchcraft. There's a lot of churches, a lot of witches that come to church in intentions of wanting to curse people. There's like supposedly 1.4 million witches that attend church. That's what Rabbi Jonathan Kahn said, if you know who Jonathan Kahn is. That's a lot. And I've seen it. I've seen there's witches on Facebook and stuff that will teach classes and they will astral project. They can do this. They can curse. And it works. And so we have to make sure that we are strong in who we are in Christ and that we truly forgive everybody. You know, the enemy's goal is to do something bad to you and get you to remember that the rest of your life so that you never can get over it. And if you can't ever get over it, then the enemy's got the right to keep tormenting your thoughts. You're not going to have peace. You're going to make decisions that aren't good. And the enemy's going to cause you to not see it in yourself and then to blame other people. Oftentimes blame your spouse. And we see this where, well, anyone who ever watched the movie The Shack, or heard of The Shack, or read the book The Shack. So when The Shack movie came out, I didn't have time to watch it. And then I heard there was some controversy. I'm like, oh, I don't know what the controversy is, but I'm too busy. Well, then the Lord said, watch it. I want you to watch this. And I'm like, all right, so turn on The Shack, watched it. And if you've not heard about it, the premise of it is this boy gets beaten up by his father in a shack. And it causes him to be angry at God for not protecting him. And so later as he grows up, he's still mad at God, doesn't trust God. And this is a typical scenario for millions of people in the world. And so what they do is they actually take him into like a cave and they have like an angel there. And it's like, hey, you're so mad at God, they're going to have you be God. And you decide who goes to heaven and hell. He's like, I don't want to do that. No. He's like, yeah, you're going to do that. So they showed him some videos of people who were doing bad things, killing people and whatever. And they're like, okay, he goes to hell, he goes to hell, she goes to hell, he goes to hell. Then they showed a little boy, like 7 years old. He's like, oh, well, little boy, he shouldn't go to hell. You know, he's an innocent little victim. He's innocent. And then they pan back, remember, and they show a man beating him up in a shack. He said, that little boy was your father. And all of a sudden it hit him. Oh my gosh. That's why my dad beat me up, is because his dad beat him up. And that's what goes on. A lot of times people call that like a generational curse. But it's a wound that never got healed from grandpa, that he took it out on dad, who then took it out on me, and then I take it out on my son. And it continues to go down all the way, infinity. And that's why we're seeing a whole bunch of people not having peace, not having joy, not having fruit of the Spirit. And the Lord's coming back for a pure and spotless bride. And there's a lot of people in the church that aren't yet pure and spotless. They've got a lot of spots. They're impure, and they're ungodly, and there's a fruit of the flesh, which is Galatians 5, 16 through 26. It talks about a lot of the fruit of the flesh. And then it goes into the fruit of the Spirit. Well, when we're not healed and we keep hearing these voices, we're going to have a lot of fruit of the flesh. We're going to end up being prideful. We're not going to take ownership in what we do to hurt other people. We're going to think we're always right, and then we're going to get mad at other people, and then oftentimes trigger on them. Again, all a triggering is when you go off on somebody. This is an unhealed soul wound from the past. So I'm going to teach you basically how tonight we're going to take you through some soul wound healing, which the Lord's going to show you some wounds that you've been hurt by, that you've not completely forgiven the person, or he's going to explain to you why something happened to you and how it affected you. And then that way you're going to be able to be healed from that. And then we can command any demonic spirits that attach to those wounds to be gone, so you don't hear that thought again and again. How do you know when you've been healed from that stuff? You can recall it and remember it without the tears that go with it. And I can recall some of the bad stuff that happened to me. It's like, no, this is just a matter of fact. It's kind of like when people go to heaven and they actually see Jesus. Actually, my brother, who had passed on just a couple months ago, he had been taken to heaven, actually, about a year ago. And he saw Jesus and said, well, does he have holes in his hands? He's like, yeah. He goes, what he does is he shows you the holes in his hands. And, yep, it happened to me. He doesn't have tears coming down because he was healed along the way. He could forgive them. Father, forgive them. So if we've not forgiven somebody yet, we're going to remember something and have tears because it really still hurts us today. And there's legal rights the enemy has. When we forgive, we completely forgive them. We can see them oftentimes then through Christ's eyes and say, okay, they were just hurting when they grew up. And that's what caused them to be a really mean person. And now I can give them grace and I can forgive them. Okay, Lord, I give them to you. You know, and then they have to deal with the Lord on their own to be reconciled. But we need to do our part. Forgiveness brings healing to us. So I'm going to play a song that called Matthew West. Anybody heard of Matthew West? I love Matthew West. He plays a lot of good songs. They have a lot of good words and meanings. He came out with a song in October of last year. I heard it for the first time in December. Played it a bunch of times. And the Lord said, I want you to play it before every time you go through the soul and healing process with people, because it will set the stage, because it's truth, what he's speaking about. And I couldn't wait. I was like, oh my gosh, every church in America, they're going to be playing this song on the radio. It's going to be awesome. And I heard nothing. No radios were playing. And I have XM Sirius radio, so I have the message on my car, driving all over America. I've been doing full-time ministry, driving all over the place since April 2017, including Canada. And yeah, they have churches in Canada. Did you know that? They do. So anyway, they never played this. And I kept waiting for them to play it. Well, it wasn't until I went to Fort Wayne, Indiana, which is where I grew up at, that they played it in July. And now they're playing it on the message, and they play it all the time. In fact, on the way here, I heard it. They played it. I'm like, oh my gosh, this is so great. So more and more people probably will hear this, or maybe you already heard this, but I'm going to have them play the song Truth Be Told by Matthew West. And then after we play this song, we're going to go through some soul revealing, where I'm going to have the Holy Spirit show each of you individually some things that hurt you in the past that you've not yet completely forgiven and not gotten over yet, so that you can get over it. I'm going to have Jesus give you a word individually so you can hear why did that person do that. And then we're going to say, okay, I choose to forgive them. I give them to you, Lord, completely. I mean it with my heart. Then we're going to come out and we go in Jesus' name. Very calm. So if you're ready, go ahead and play.
I number one, you're supposed to have it all together. And when they ask how you doing, just smile and tell them you're never better. Lie number two, everybody's life is perfect except yours. So keep your messes and your wounds and your secrets safe with you behind closed doors. The truth is rarely told. I say I'm fine, yeah, I'm fine, oh, I'm fine, hey, I'm fine, but I'm not. I'm broken, and when it's out of control, I say it's under control, but it's not. And you know it, I don't know why it's so hard to admit it. But being honest is the only way to fix it. There's no failure, no fall, there's no sin, you don't already know. So let the truth be told. There's a sign on the door, says come as you are, but I doubt it. Cause if we lived like that was true, every Sunday morning pew would be crowded. You know.
love that song, because when you think about your life and you look back, you know, and when you're honest, you know, you're going to have wounds. We all have wounds. We live in an imperfect world. You know, we're going to get hurt, some worse than others. And it's sad when we've grown up and we have a father or a mother that doesn't love us the way that we should, or said something to us harshly, or we were, I've seen this a lot, where you got a family where maybe the mom and the dad loved, you know, in a decent way, but then one of the children was either touched in a sexual way they shouldn't have been touched, and then it affected them. And oftentimes they didn't even tell the mom and the dad. And then they have behavior that's really bad. And then people look at them and say, oh my gosh, what's wrong with your son? What's wrong with your daughter? You know, that happened with me and my family. And I didn't know what to do. It went on for 10 years before I finally learned that it was after thousands of dollars of spending it on the best money could buy, Christian counseling and medication, and nothing worked. I was taught that I had an authority in Jesus Christ that I could pray and take over my son, and I could command that stuff to go. I never was told that. Even in the church, I wasn't told that. And I'm like, I tried everything, you know, and 10 years of hell went through. So I'm like, okay, I'll try it. I'll try anything. And so I was taught that. I commanded the enemy to go, not even knowing that he even had demonic thoughts. I didn't know, because the church preached to me that, oh, Christians can't have demons. And guess what? The next day, he was completely a changed person. He was compliant. He was loving. He was kind. And then his picture, I have a picture of him, I can show you that. The before and after is dramatically different. I mean, I got my son back after 10 years of hell with a 40-second prayer. And I'm like, my gosh. If I didn't know that, if I was never taught that, I believe he would have been dead or in jail. And there's a lot of people that are in jail who have been hurt by their mom, by their dad, by sexual stuff. They don't want to do that. They're tormented. And all people do is see the outside of the pain being manifested in ways that look bad. But they can't help it. You know, the only way to get through to them is to have them forgive. That's a huge, huge part. You got to forgive. You forgive people. You get freed yourself and healed. And then you humble yourself from the pride, and then you command the enemy to go. And now you got, instead of 50,000 negative thoughts a day, maybe you got 1,000 positive thoughts. It's amazing. I've seen my own life. This is 2009, I started paying attention to my thoughts. And by like 2015, no longer did I have any thoughts from the enemy, because I was on to him. I finally realized that the reason why there's so much strife in relationships and marriages is because one of us or both of us is hearing from the enemy, and it causes us to manifest that way. And we don't know. We think it's them, it's always that way. Well, if they've been hurt in the past, then they need to get healed. And so what we're going to do is we go through some healing of the past wounds, and then you can do this on your own. I've done this on myself. If you ever overreact to something, you get really mad, really angry or something, it means there's an unhealed soul wound. So when you get mad and angry, what you do, you say, okay, Lord, I'm going to separate off any demonic spirits from my soul in Jesus' name. And now I just ask you, Jesus, give me a word. What's going on? Why am I getting so upset? Why am I getting in fear? Why am I getting angry? And the Lord will give you the word to heal that, to understand what's going on. Then you take the authority that Jesus gave when he died on the cross. He gave us that authority to take. He waits for us to do it and say, I command in Jesus' name, any demonic spirits to be gone in Jesus' name, and then you're back at peace again. And then you, next time something happens and looks and smells just like that, you won't trigger again. You're healed from it. I remember with my first wife, I was jealous. Didn't know why. Always jealous. Got remarried to my second wife. It was gone. The Lord healed me from that. I couldn't believe it. I was like, man, I like this new Nelson. I mean, I was patient, I was kind, I was gentle, I was completely a whole bunch different, a whole bunch better than I was with my first one. I didn't know why, because no one ever taught me this. So what I'm going to do is bring you through three different instances of your life. And it could be something that was huge that you still haven't gotten over yet. You know, sometimes like the enemy will get us into doing something that we feel guilty and ashamed about. You know, it could be sexual, could be abortions, could be getting angry and being really mad and can't stop it. But whatever it is, I'm just going to pray right now. Holy Spirit, show them on the first ones the most major pain that they've not completely been healed from yet. Right now, in the name of Jesus. So just get quiet. And the Lord's going to show you and bring back something to your memory. From the soul wound in Jesus' name on you. And now I ask Jesus to come and give you a word, give you some insight, give you a vision even, give you some understanding. Why did that person or why did that situation happen to you? So that you can truly forgive and or understand it better. So Jesus, come and give them a word right now in Jesus' name. Amen. Attach those wounds to go to the pit now in Jesus' name. Declare that you will never be tormented in a negative way when you think about that anymore. You can think about it matter-of-factly, and it will not have any effects on you. So let's go to a second one now. Hey, Lord, Holy Spirit, show them another wound. Someone that betrayed them, someone that hurt them, someone that lied about them, someone that could have been sexually molested them, myriad of things. And show them another wound that you want to heal in their life from their past. All right. Now we just separate off again the demonic spirits that attach those wounds in Jesus' name so they can't interfere. We ask Jesus to come and give them a word now. Some insight as to what happened there so that they can forgive. All right. Now it's just that I choose to forgive and can name their name. To heal their soul wounds. In Jesus' name, amen. Right now, we take authority to command again every demonic spirit that attached those wounds to be going to the pit in Jesus' name, and you will not be affected by that anymore. Thank you, Father, for healing them in Jesus' name. And oftentimes, you may feel lighter as you go through this process, and you feel more joy. It's like you can remember, you don't have all the bitterness or the anger that goes with it. They were just hurting. They did horrible things to me. You can acknowledge that, on the truth, being honest, but now it's just a matter of, like, it's a matter of fact. That's a part of your history. All right, let's do another one. I do three of these, basically. So Holy Spirit, again, show them another wound. Could be a betrayal. Could be a rejection from a boyfriend or a girlfriend in school. Could then, again, that you were born prematurely. Could be a father, mother that hurt you, yeah, stepfather, stepmother, teacher, even people in church. So, Holy Spirit, show them another one that you want to heal. Spirits from that wound in Jesus' name, and we just ask Jesus to come to give them word of insight on that situation so that they can forgive. Choose to forgive and begin name their names. And so I ask you, Lord, to heal their souls. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, again, we take authority to command again every demonic spirit that attached those wounds to go to the pit. In Jesus' name, amen. And that's how you do it. I used to, and you can go ahead and stop the music, background music. Thank you. I used to say to people, all you have to do is to forgive. I'm thinking, well, that's all you have to do. But for a lot of people are like, okay, I said I forgive, but man, I hate them. You know, if they were to walk in there right now, oh my gosh, I would punch them. I'm so mad. I'm like, well, you've not forgiven them yet. You still have some work to do. And so what to help speed that process up is to say, Lord, give me some insight about them. I'm so mad and angry. Why did my dad do that? Why did my mom do that? Why did my cousin, my brother, my best friend at school, why did they cheat on me? And then you get the word from the Lord, they'll say, well, I'll give you the reason so you can understand it. You may not like it, but at least you can understand it. And then, yeah, choose to forgive if you want to be free. If you don't want to be free, you don't have to. You can still get mad and angry and bitter and want to take vengeance upon them. But all that does is make us, it's like we're drinking the poison ourselves, hoping that they die. And it's not going to work that way. So what I've learned is that the enemy's job is to try to hurt us as much as he can. And the earlier that he can do it, we are defenseless, typically, when we're young, when we're 0 to 10 years of age. That's when it really impacts us, and then it can affect us the rest of our life. If we have somebody that says something mean to us when we're 5, we can't really process that. How do we process it? When we're 30 or 40, we can say, well, that person is just being bad or mean. I can forgive them. Hopefully you can do that. But oftentimes, if you've not gotten the forgiveness when you were younger, you can't do it when you get older. Because you have all these things backed up of all this unforgiveness and anger, and all it does is hurt us. And so that's how it works. I remember I didn't understand that with the church my whole life. I knew that I was supposed to forgive, but then I didn't pay attention to the thoughts. When I started paying attention to my thoughts, I'm like, okay, that thought's coming from the enemy. I remember once I had, I'll say this, so I started learning about, my mentor said, you know, Nelson, eventually you'll be able to walk in being healed from everything. And that started in 2009 when I started learning this process. And I've now been healed from everything. Doesn't mean I don't get stuff on me, which I've gotten stuff on me, like a bulge the size of a golf ball on my spine. But I've been healed now of everything. And I don't take anything. I don't take any medications. I don't take Tylenol, ibuprofen, nothing. I don't take vitamins either. And I remember I used to, my mom died of a heart attack at 55, my dad died of a heart attack at 67. So I started running marathons, thinking, okay, I'm gonna be healthy, I'm not gonna die of a heart attack. So I started running marathons, I ran like 5 or 6 marathons. And then my mentor's like, why are you running marathons? I'm like, well, because I don't wanna die of a heart attack like my mom did at age 55. He's like, okay, so you're in fear. I'm like, no, I'm not. He's like, yes, you are. I'm like, okay, maybe I am. he goes, do you enjoy running 26.2 miles? I'm like, no, not really. I go on a train at like 6 months, and it's like 80 miles a week, and no, it's, I go, I'd like to exercise just for the fun of it. He said, why don't you do that? Just exercise for the fun of it. Enjoy yourself. I'm like, oh, okay. He goes, and as you learn your authority, and understand, you know, that there is witchcraft out there, people can cast spells, and they can. But he said to help yourself is that you need to forgive. In fact, the Lord showed me this when I was in Wyoming last year, and I went to the Badlands. Anyone been to the Badlands of South Dakota? They're bad. They're so dusty and dirty, and it's kind of cool looking. But man, I come out of that, my car's filthy. So I have to get my car washed. And I drive again all over the place. I live with people like 65% of the time and stay in Marriott's like 35% of the time. So Marriott loves me. and I do some industry in Marriott's now in the hotels. They love me since COVID started. Like, okay, we want your money, come here. And so I'll put them, we'll do them in hotels and stuff. So, but even Interestingly, when I got my car washed, I'm like, okay, Lord, I would love to just wash my car once a year. So I'm like, I have to do this every week, and it's blood splattered all over it, and it's dirty and dusty. And the Lord's like, gave me an example of something that is so profound yet so simple in the 4 minutes that I went through the car wash. He said, yeah. He goes, Nelson, he goes, where did you go yesterday? I'm like, well, a bunch of the Badlands. He said, so, people on earth are living in the Badlands. There are people who have been hurt, who have demonic spirits that hurt lots of people, and they're in the church, and their goal of the demonic spirits is to get you to be hurt and to take an offense and be angry and remember what they did over and over again. So how do you get clean? I go, I got to forgive, and you mean it with my heart. He said, yes, that's what you have to do. So he said, how often do you have to do that? As often as they do bad things to me in the Badlands? He said, yes. So he said, especially I'm in the ministry of deliverance, there's going to be people that I'm working with that have some problems with hearing the voice of the enemy, demonic spirits. They're going to say things and do things that are going to not be good. So I have to forgive. So he said, that's the only way you can keep your soul cleansed, is to forgive and keep forgiving for the rest of your life. I'm like, oh man, I would love to just forgive once and be done with that. And they get mad and angry when people do bad things to me. He's like, you can't. You got to keep forgiving. I'm like, but they do some really bad things, and they lie really badly, and it really hurts, and they gang up, and they get other people to believe lies. He said, yeah, that's what the job of the enemy is to do, isn't it? And your job is to keep forgiving. He said, when you forgive, there's nothing that can attach to you. The enemy has no legal rights to come against you with anything. And I'm like, So I'm like, then I guess I need to keep forgiving no matter what anybody says or does. He said, yes, you do. And make sure that you get that message across to the people. Because the goal of the enemy is to have someone come up and lie about you, say something bad, trash your name, whisper about you, gossip, you know, a myriad of things. And their job is they got to keep forgiving. And that's how they keep your soul cleansed and clean. I'm like, huh. So essentially, when you're around people who have not been healed yet and delivered yet, they're going to say things and do things that are going to hurt you. So do you think you want to have them be your best friend? You know, in some situations, what did Jesus say? Jesus said he came for everybody to have peace, right? Jesus came for peace on earth, right? That's right. No, Jesus came for division. No, see, it ain't so. Yes, he did. He said that. I came in for division. He said there's going to be father against son, mother against daughter, mother-in-law against mother or daughter-in-law. Why? Why? But why did he say that? Because people who choose Jesus are going to have Jesus within them. And the people that have not gotten healed yet and delivered and set free, they're going to have the demonic spirits in them. And you think Jesus can hang out with the Pharisees and scribes and get along with them? No. You think Elijah can hang out with Jezebel and get along with her? No. So if a person has not been healed and delivered yet, and you've been healed and delivered, they're going to say things to try to reject you and hurt you. And so if they're your best friend, they may not be a very good best friend. You may want to have an inner circle that's changing. You know, I know sometimes you can't pick it, like your father or your son or your mother, daughter. But what that means is, let's say that you go through and get yourself set free and delivered, but your mom and dad haven't yet. And they still say things that hurt you. You think maybe it's wise to probably limit your conversations with them and love them from afar?
Yeah.
Yes. If you want peace, if you don't want peace, then go ahead and see them all day long and let them speak forth a whole bunch of crap that's going to hurt you over and over and over, and then complain about it to your spouse. And the spouse is like, why are you doing this? Is this resonating with anybody here? Yes. It's true, you know. And so, and it's hard because oftentimes I've seen this. We've got to really control whatever, father or mother. And then the child's like, oh, I want their love and approval. So they keep going over there and it's like, thank you, Mom. Can I have another? Thank you, Dad. Can I have another? And they keep doing that. And it's like, I'm sorry. I know you want the love, but they need delivery. Otherwise, all you're going to do is get more hurt and more pain. And so, I can't relate. My mom and dad don't like that. But I've dealt with thousands and thousands around the world that it's like that. And so, it's like, you got to protect yourself. Because it's demonic is what they're doing, and they're not healed. And you're going to get slimed whenever you're around them. And then your spouse is going to be like, why are you doing this? You did it again. I already told you this like 1,000 times. We're like, just maybe thinking this time they're going to actually have some luck. Well, sorry, not again. You know, so yes, you can honor your parents. You're supposed to honor them. That doesn't mean keep abusing me every day. Let's get on the phone for 5 hours. You're going to chew me out and you can blame me for everything that happened 3 years ago. So we got to forgive, and then we need to put up boundaries. Of course, we've read the books, boundaries, some of that doesn't go deep enough into the demonic to understand this is what's going on. So now, I'm going to explain the top three demonic spirits that affect most everybody in the world. And when you understand this, your eyes get open. You see this in other people. And I'm going to read through this. There's actually some TV shows you'll see this on the back. Remember Little House on the Prairie?
Yes.
Okay, I'm going to talk about the spirit of Jezebel, spirit of Leviathan, spirit of Ahab. I never even heard of Leviathan. Leviathan's in Job 41. It's the king over all the children of pride. So people that get hurt always will have pride. And then the spirit of Jezebel will come on. Those that have been hurt a lot, hurt the deepest. Jezebel causes, it's comprised of a whole bunch of different spirits, a whole bunch of different behaviors. But these are the behaviors. So when you go to the doctor, and you say, doctor, I'm having this problem, what does he do? He always asks you, what are your symptoms? So we have to be honest. You go to the doctor, if you lie about your symptoms, I've never even told this before, the Holy Spirit just told me this right now. This is so good. If you go to the doctor and you lie about your symptoms and say, I'm all sweet and nice and happy and da-da-da-da, and you don't tell the truth, he's not going to be able to diagnose correctly, and you're not going to get healed.
This is good.
So we have to be honest. I have always said this. Is if we're not honest about ourselves, and the enemy doesn't want us to. The enemy doesn't want us to say, oh my God, I've done some bad things. No, the enemy wants to blame everything on other people. So we have to be honest to be free. So if you go to the doctor, you've got to be honest. It's like, it hurts here, it hurts there. These are my symptoms. So I'm going to read off some symptoms under this thing called Sir Jezebel. Jezebel was in 1 Kings, 2 Kings. She married Ahab. Ahab should not have married her. She was not a godly woman. He did it because she was wealthy, comes from a family of wealth, and it was a political win for him. And this is what Jezebel will cause us to behave like. And people that struggle with this spirit are because they've been hurt a lot when they grew up, or significantly. You know, you can get it because I had one situation with a person that her parents were Jehovah's Witness, and they disowned her when she was 17, wouldn't talk to her anymore. That's painful, absolutely. And I've had other people that pick this up because they were sexually touched, like once when they were 5. That's all it takes. Now, how many people I've talked to, this one girl, woman, just this past week I did a session with her, her dad hired a carpenter to work, and the carpenter touched her sexually. And then within a month, she touched her friend sexually. Why? Because she got infected by the same demonic spirits because of that man. That man would have been infected by somebody else and causing him to do that. And it just goes on. That's how it all works. So Jezebel, the spirit, will give us these characteristics, these symptoms. We will be anxious and fearful. Have lots of thoughts in our mind that we can't turn off. And it started whenever we first were hurt and wounded. Could have been in the womb. Could have been a lot of fighting going on with mom and dad. Could have been at birth, when it was a scary birth. That, oh my gosh. Could have been wounds from school, from kids, from a dad, from a stepdad, myriad of people. It causes us then, because of that wound, to not trust our spouse, not trust other people make decisions. So therefore, we need to control every decision that is made because the enemy is telling us that our decisions are the best. And you can't trust anybody else because, hey, your dad let you down or your mom let you down. So it makes sense, but then it wrecks and wreaks havoc on our relationships. We end up self-sabotaging and there's no peace in our lives, no peace in the relationship. So it causes us to control other people, to make them do what we want. We're manipulative so that we get our way, so we can guilt trip some people. You know what? You don't watch my children on the weekend so that I can go to this party. I'm going to have a neighbor watch them. And you know what? They're not saved. They're not Christians. And if they get molested, that will be all your fault. They'll say things like that, as an example. But they're manipulative. They're also very jealous, jelly. So they're very, very jealous, and they don't know why. You know, I'll, I can say this, this is a personal example, is worshiping up at the front in this one church, and I was getting words from people, prophetic words. And 80% of the people that were worshiping were women. And you know what? More than 50% of the words I got were for women. And yet that caused my wife to be jealous. And he said, "We know you're not supposed to be giving words to women. That's not proper." I'm like, "What? I'm in church. I'm getting a word from the Lord. I can't help it that 80% are women." I go, so then I purposely tried to only get words for men. And I'm like, "You know what? I don't think that's right." You know? That's crazy, you know, and it's because she was jealous and had not been healed yet in the wounds in the past. So, but it caused us to be jealous. And I was jealous with my first wife. I'm like, "Oh my gosh, I was jealous of any guy that she might talk to." And it felt real to me. I'm like, "Ah," and it just, it was awful. So, it causes jealousy, causes us to be angry when other people are happy. Also, I'll say this. You ever been around people on the holidays or birthdays or anniversaries where they will oftentimes make that holiday bad? They will want the attention and they will say things to hurt other people or ruin the holidays over and over and over and birthdays. You know, if somebody's birthday will try to be the one that, that gets all the attention because they can't stand somebody else getting the attention when it's their birthday. So it'll cause us to do that. It'll cause us to be demanding, defiant, selfish. Oftentimes there's a sexual impurity that will happen, and it causes us to believe things that are not true. It's called a false narrative. So, and it also causes us to react and trigger, so we have an alternate personality. Well, this alternate personality, truth be told, is getting, is hearing our voices of the enemy, demonic spirits. So it causes us to believe a false narrative. So we can say things to other people, or even our spouse, like the next day, when they say, "Why did you do what you did?" And they're like, "What?" And they repeat something that never happened, but they believe that it did. And you're like, "Oh my gosh, I think I'm going crazy." And they believe it, and they'll be adamant about it. And then they'll oftentimes go to other people, if you're having problems in your marriage, and they'll spread lies about the person and not be honest. And I see this all the time. It's like, and the person doesn't know what happened. Like, when they come to the church, and the whole church is looking at them like they're Satan. And they're like, "Oh my gosh, what happened? I think my spouse said something about me." And everybody's gossiping about it. And I don't think it's true. I don't know what it is, because nobody wants to talk to me. And they all turn their backs on me. So this is the number one reason for church splits and why churches don't grow. It's because there's people that have this spirit of Jezebel. Because what does Jezebel in the Bible want to do? They wanted to kill the voice of the prophet. They wanted to shut down the Lord. Did not want to have godliness. You know, and today, they want to shut down the Holy Spirit from operating in churches. So it knows how to do it by spreading lies. Oftentimes, it'll go to, you know, it'll try to spread lies and rumors about a pastor. The pastor's got a good heart and loving. And then they'll spread a bunch of lies, and before you know it, one by one, people are leaving the church, and the pastor's going to lie. And it's horrible. It's horrible because they've not been healed from their wounds in the past, not been delivered yet. So, again, Jesus is coming back to appear in spotless bride. He may come back in 8 years or less. Just think. Just think if he comes back and we're still operating in this. It's not good. We want to be healed from all this. He's coming back to appear in spotless bride. So, it causes us to lie and to believe the lies as truth. Wants to shut down the true Holy Spirit. Oftentimes, wants to desire power and leadership over other people so it can control. They'll intimidate people, threaten people. They're rebellious. They're suspicious of people's intentions. They're critical, judgmental. They'll show contempt and disrespect. They'll take offense at the drop of a hat, so they're hyper-offensive. So if you do one thing they don't like, man, they are on you. But if they go off on you all day long, you have to take it and shut your mouth and bow down to them. The spirit wants. So they argue about petty things. They'll overtalk you so you can't get a word in edgewise. So if you're trying to, you know, get into an argument, it's like fruitless. It's just a waste of time. You get exhausted and they'll twist it and have 10 different points of view going on, and you're just like, "Oh my gosh, I can't even keep up with this." But if you go into a counseling session with a pastor or a counselor, the person that struggles more with this spirit will try to dominate and have as much airtime as possible so that the real truth can't get out. And then they'll want to have sidebar conversations with the pastor and the counselor so they can get them on their side and to believe their truth, which is not truth. Resonate with anybody? Like, it's like the 800-pound gorilla in like every church in the world. It just is. And the Lord said, I want my church pure and spotless, because the Lord's come back with that. And there's a lot of people that aren't there yet. So anyway, it causes us to exaggerate a lot of things, rarely ever admit that we're wrong. Remember Happy Days? Remember Fonzie? He couldn't say it was wrong. He didn't cry. Kept trying to say it. I'm sorry. I was wrong. He couldn't do it to the very end. And he's trying to say I was wrong. He had to humble himself. They act sweet and innocent. Oftentimes, they want attention, though. They want to act like they're a victim. So a victim mentality is really hard because they were hurt, but then they keep going back and thinking that, well, I'm always the victim, and I'm always being hurt when truth be told, but oftentimes the bully. They end up demanding and running away all the time. They act sweet and innocent, but it's not real. They cannot stand to be told no. They feel like they have to be your personal policeman. They'll report on you to anybody and everybody. They'll keep notes and everything and say, okay, I'm going to tell this about you and this about you. And you're just like, oh my gosh. There's no intimacy in the marriage. There's no intimacy when it comes to intimacy. I call it outimacy. Because it's just not pure and godly. It's not the way that it should be. And very few couples experience that. They go through inner healing and deliverance, they will, because now they get to hear the voice of the Lord. They actually have good behavior, godly behavior. That is amazing. I'm not going to go through everything. There's a whole bunch, though. You're in my book, Restorative Freedom. If you can, I've got them on YouTube. I've got them on my Facebook page. So those that have the strongest level of the spirit, Jessica, would be called narcissists, if you're familiar with that term. People that are called that, it's, you know, it feels bad and sad, but... And I've been out to these narcissist support groups on Facebook, and there's a lot of angry people that have been in relationships with those people, and they have a hard time forgiving them. Like, they were horrible to me. I'm like, yeah, we're, but you gotta forgive. I'll never forgive. You want the goal of the enemy is to have somebody that gets hurt, and then gets in a relationship, and then hurts that person, and causes them not to be able to forgive them, and then the demons have the right to torment them. And that's how it works. Leviathan, it's in Job 41. And this is also in Isaiah, it's in Psalms. There's like seven different chapters of Leviathan's in. But Job 41 describes all that does is describe Leviathan, which is pride. Pride, king over all the children of pride, verse 34. People that struggle with Jezebel will always have pride because it blocks us from seeing ourselves. And that's why I always say you've got to own your own issues. If we don't own our own issues, the issues have legal right to own us. If we can't look in the mirror and be honest and say, okay, I will own that. I was way out of line. Please forgive me. You know, humble, you have to humble yourself to do that. When you don't have humility, the enemy will block you and you won't see it and it will ruin the intimacy with your relationship. There's oftentimes a false humility that people can have, but it will twist communication in the person's mind. So it describes, if you read Job 41, it describes a water thingy, kind of like an alligator, and oftentimes people will have dreams about alligators. That's the Lord's way of showing them that they're dealing with the spirit called Leviathan. And what does an alligator do when it ends up attacking its prey? It twists and twists. So literally what happens is you'll have twisted communication. Like you'll be talking about something, the next thing you know, they're hearing something completely different. Like I had one woman say, hey, her husband, I'm going down to the grocery store to get some groceries tonight. So I'll be back in an hour. And then the husband's like, what? You're going to the bar tonight? And you're not going to get back till midnight? What are you talking about? He swore that's what she said. I was like, I did not say that. And then I had another guy that said that his wife had gone off and went off horrible on him on the day before. And then he wants to talk about it the next day. So I was like, so honey. No, and she would not take responsibility. She completely did not say how the series of events went. She was unhonest. It was completely twisted. It was not truthful at all. And so he's just like, okay, I can't even talk. You know, I don't know what's going on. You know, it's hard to understand that, but it will twist the communication in your mind. It will also twist things if you're in a business or school or whatever venue with people. You could be working with a colleague that's struggling with this because they were hurt when they grew up. I had a couple bosses that were been considered struggling with Jezebel and Viacom, and they're very prideful, very not fun to work for, and they would twist things. And I'm like, what? I never said that. And they're like, well, yes, you did. So they ruin the productivity of the company. So that's why I'm like, if I was the president of the company, I'd have everybody go through interview and deliverance. Because you'd be a whole lot more productive, and then they'd be a whole much happier at home instead of having to pay all these counseling sessions and psychology things. I mean, you'd be guilty from all this stuff. So, but this is the interesting thing. I had a healing room in Indiana when I did start doing this ministry back in 2015, 2016. And the Lord said, take everybody through deliverance all the time. Every time you have them go through, they forgive. And invariably, people that struggle with Leviathan would oftentimes have back pain and neck pain and headaches. And they couldn't sleep well through the night. Because literally, they could feel that spirit when they started actually knowing about this. Oh my gosh, I feel it. It's on my back. Oh my gosh, yes, I have back pain. I have neck pain. I have headaches. Some of them have scoliosis. A lot of them go to the chiropractor a lot. Most chiropractors, you know, that aren't dealing with car accidents and things like that, are dealing with the spirit of Leviathan. So then the patient keeps coming back. And you know, I used to go to chiropractor all the time since I was like 7. And I couldn't get healed all the time. And I would go back and get crunch, 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 crunch. I had headaches and I couldn't play basketball. My 7th grade basketball year. Once I got delivered back in 2008, right before 2009, I didn't have my anymore. I haven't had a headache for 2011 years. That's crazy. I used to always have headaches. But I'm like, oh my gosh, I don't have headaches anymore. And I deal with people that have Jezebel a lot, you know. Those are bad things. And so I love them. They're very good people. But headaches, insomnia, causes you to go drowsy, fall asleep when you read the Bible or Christian books, scoliosis, fibromyalgia. And I noticed this, because again, I want to know what the truth is. The Lord showed me that if you have a relative, say father, grandfather, mother, grandmother, that was ever making an oath to the enemy that would end up cursing their bloodline, like down the bloodline, in order to do whatever, oftentimes to make money, there's organizations that are out there. I started researching. I knew some people that were involved in some of these things. One of them is called Freemasons. You see it almost in every, and I've driven around the country, I've seen it. Welcome to town, Freemasons, right there. Freemasons, Shriners. To be a Shriner, you have to be a 33rd degree Mason. That means you've had, at the 30th degree, you are saying, basically, that I'm going to serve Satan at that point. You know what you're doing is evil. And I've seen this time and time and time again. When I ask a person, so do you know if your father, grandfather, or mother, there's a thing called Eastern Star, that's for women, if they were involved in that and they stayed in it very long, they will make them say these curses against their family members. And I saw this one woman, she had 4th stage lung cancer. She was from Minnesota, wanted healed, called me. And as I'm going through, getting ready to pray for her, the Lord showed me that she had a grandfather involved in Freemasons. So I said, is that true? And she said, yes. I'm like, and I explained to her, like I said, well, the oath they make, if it was in it very long, it will come down and it will affect you. And you can oftentimes see it in the entire family. And she's like, I had a dream like 3 weeks ago, and in the dream was Jesus and my grandfather, and Jesus told me in the dream the reason I had cancer was because of my grandfather. I'm like, yeah. I said, if anybody else in your family has cancer, she said, yes, we all do. And I know another guy that his father was involved in Freemasons, and he had 2 children that died of cystic fibrosis. And he's like, he knows. And he had a mother, too, that was involved in Eastern Star. So if you do the research on this, you can find it on the internet. You can see the oaths that they make. And there's people that do Facebook, Facebook and YouTubes that used to be in it. And they will tell the truth and say, this is what went on. And it's not good. And so their hopes is to make a bunch of money. You know, if you get a whole bunch of people that are in this organization, they can protect each other. And they'll try to recruit judges so they can get preferential treatment. I'm not saying that again, every judge is involved in that because they're not. But I have heard and seen in my own eyes, this one guy, he became a Shriner. And he had terrible physical pains in his body. He ultimately died. And he never really got freed from it. He came out of it, came into the church. He was trying to, but because he had made these oaths, and the way that they do it, it's almost like by the time they get to the shrine, they can't repent and go backwards. I mean, maybe they can, but at least the guy that I knew could not, and he ended up, it was a grisly passage. So, but there's organizations that are out there, and if we don't know, well, I would say we need to break off whatever. We need to break off any generation curse, anyone that's above us that said anything that would be affecting us. We want to break it off in Jesus' name, take our authority, that we're not affected by that. You know, I was affected. My grandfather was a Freemason. I didn't know it. He was a farmer. And I was a farmer being a Freemason. Now, I didn't know until after he passed away. He was bow-legged. He had back issues. I have back issues. I had scoliosis. I inherited that. I was an innocent little kid. I didn't know anything. I didn't do anything wrong. But he got into that because he could sell his product, his animals, to other people that were Freemasons and get a better price, whatever. So that's why he got into it. I didn't know it. I didn't know until after he died. I mean, they had these Masons come and wear their aprons, and then we all left as a family. But nobody had ever said, that was bad. We shouldn't do that. Well, I didn't know. My dad was still alive when his dad passed away. But so that's Jezebel Leviathan. Again, those two come together, and that describes about half of the people in the world. And truth be told, most people struggle with all three of these to some degree. I struggle with all three, but you'll normally default to one way or the other. More of the Jezebel side, controlling, running your way more, and then the other person be more they have. You see it probably 85% of relationships in the world, is what the Lord told me. And I see it all the time. Where you have one person that takes on the characteristics more, running to control and get their way, marrying somebody that is Ahab. Ahabs, they oftentimes have a position of influence or money. They do not like confrontations. They will tolerate ungodly behavior and decisions. They have a hard time being a strong spiritual leader. Strong desire to make everybody happy. Afraid of being rejected. So they oftentimes stay in these toxic relationships. And they just feel like, oh well, that's my lot in life. You know, and I know that when I was struggling more with the spirit of Ahab, but again, I had tendencies to be Jezebel Leviathan at times, to be truth be told. But I wanted to be a strong spiritual leader, and I couldn't do it because my dad wasn't that way. You know, and his dad wasn't that way. So it's like it's hard to be something that we don't have a model for. So I have become now the way that I, more of the way that I should be, but it took some work on my part. I had to repent, say, Lord, I'm sorry for operating in the spirit of Ahab. You know, more of that, but also repent for Jezebel and Leviathan. And then the enemy was gone. And now I can stand up and say, okay, I want purity and righteousness and holiness now. I'm not going to tolerate stuff that is not godly. Because most times people know that if they struggle with the Ahab spirit, better just let it go. Just let it slide, you know, because if I bring this up, it's going to be an argument. It's going to go on for hours. So I'll just let it go. Well, then you keep tolerating things. And so those two spirits work together to ruin most marriages, to not make them the godly marriages that they can be. And so I'm just the messenger speaking, hopefully, the truth that opens the eyes. And you'll see this in other people. So let me go back. I talked about this earlier. Who was the Jezebel on Little House in the Prairie?
Nellie
was a Jezebel. And who else?
Her mother.
So Nellie picked it up because her mom was the Jezebel, controlling, gossiping, and lying, and manipulating. And then who was the Ahab? Mr. Olson. And then Willie picked up that from his dad. So isn't that amazing when you look at that? Okay, next, Gilligan's Island. Who was the Jezebel?
Ginger.
Always trying to use her seductivity to get the professor and Skipper and Gilligan. Who was the Ahabs? There's a lot of Ahabs. But really, yeah, the Skipper and Little Bunny, of course, especially Gilligan, and even the professor. The professor was smart and stuff, but he could be seduced by Jezebel, by having her put her arms around him, whatever. And so there's a lot of this that when you see this, it's like, oh my gosh, this explains so much. And so we want free from all this. So what I'm going to do is have everybody that can stand. Those that can't, go ahead and be seated. And now we're going to take our authority that Jesus gave us when he died on the cross. Again, I went to all these churches and no one ever taught me that I had an authority about this until 2009, when my mentor had taught me, and then I prayed for my son, bam, he got set free instantly after 10 years of hell that he endured, completely changed him. And so once I learned that, I'm like, okay, well, we should use this authority probably, right, Jesus? He's like, yeah, I went on the cross for it to give it to you guys, and I expect you to use it. And this, the enemy doesn't want the churches to talk about that, because then we become really dangerous, because now we're on the offensive, instead of letting the enemy keep hurting us over and over and over again. You know, I'm going to break off spirits of Jezebel, Leviathan, Ahab. There's another one called Legion. Remember the guy that had Legion? Has like 6,000 demons strong because of that. That's what the Romans army, they called them a legion. They had 6,000 people that were in that regiment. And we're going to break that off. Because Legion, what that does, that causes us to be stuck oftentimes in the wounds, in the tombs of our past. Where we remember them over and over. We don't have any hope. And we remember it over and over and over again. And so we want to break that off because Legion will actually cause a lot of afflictions and torment in our bodies, a lot of sickness, a lot of disease and stuff that we don't want. And then I'm going to break off witchcraft curses. So the Lord introduced me to a witch. I didn't want to, but he's like, there's a lot of them out there, so I'm going to help you introduce you. And then I felt some curses from them. I'm like, they really can curse. I'm like, well, that's bad, you know? And I'm like, oh my gosh, it was a pain, sciatic pain for about 6 months. And it was because of a point of contact that she gave me. It was a ring that she gave me. And it was in my car. I didn't know it until I had a dream one day. And the Lord finally showed me. He's like, oh, you need to get rid of that ring. Because she's got legal rights. I'm like, well, why didn't you tell me that 6 months ago? And I'm like, I went through pain trying to, like, drive across America and do the ministry you wanted me to do. And trying to stay in shape and work out. I've got numbness in my toes and pain. And he's like, well, because you had to learn that. If you only go through it for a day, it's not like anything, like a blur on your radar. But if you go through it for 6 months or longer, guess what? Now you will remember that. And when I go through the healing process, then you'll be able to have a testimony and share that. I'm like, oh, great. Like, oh. But anyway, what I've learned is oftentimes the best teachers are experienced. So I'm going to also pray that the Lord shows you, because oftentimes we have things in our homes that have been cursed. Or, and it could be jewelry, it could be even books, even Bibles and stuff. That people have placed a curse on, and they want you to give it to you, or they want to touch you, and they want you to come to them for prayer all the time instead of pointing you. You know, it's one thing to have a mentorship. You know, I get that. I understand. I pray for people. I want them to learn, but I don't want them to either go to a person every single day. I'm like, I don't have time for that. Right. I want you to learn. You know, get yourself to understand this, and then go to God for yourself and hear the Lord. You know, for the Lord wants to do. So what we're going to do is we're going to take our authority, and you basically just mean this with your heart, you know, because the Lord has just shown now, open up hopefully your eyes to understand this in a deeper way than maybe you've ever heard of this or seen this before. It does explain so many relationships, and it's interesting because I go around the country to get my haircuts at Sport Clips. I used to go to Great Clips. The Great Clips got me in, got me out a lot faster. And then the Sport Clips people told me, well, we need to take longer. We don't have a time limit. And so that's why we take longer. And I'm like, oh. So the Lord told me, go to Sport Clips because they take longer. And you can share more of your testimony. And you can help them. And so they always ask me, so what do you do? And I'm like, I don't start out with saying, oh, I deliver people from demons. Okay, I'm not cutting this man's hair. So I said, I used to sell software to banks. Oh, okay. I go, but now I'm in the ministry and I help people who have wounds from their fathers and mothers and stepmothers and sexual stuff to have more peace. And then they start cutting my hair closer. Yes. There's no one there dealing with it. And I start to explain. Now, what I learned is you have, you know, parents that typically one of them is more controlling and dominant than the other. They're like, yes. And I'm like, and it just leads to the whole thing. And they're like, their mind's blown. They're like, oh my gosh. And they're like, can I have a book? And I'm like, yeah, I got a book. I can get a book. And then we start. So there's a lot of restorative freedom books that are in sport clubs around the country. But it explains so much. In fact, one of the last days she cut my hair, she was in South Dakota. And she moved from New York right when the COVID was happening in March. So she got out right in time. And she said, I started describing this. She goes, you're describing my boyfriend to a T. How do you know this? Well, some experience I went through. I go, but you got the givers married to the takers. And we see that.
Right.
I go, I'm just being honest. I go, but when we get free from this stuff, we can talk about it. We can laugh about it and say, man, yeah, I was not really good. I can say that by myself. I was not really that good of a guy. I thought I was godly, but it's the pride and stuff that blocked me. So you get free from this stuff, man, you got joy, you got fun. You got seasons in the sun. You can have fun. You really can. It's like childlike innocence comes back to you. You can joke around. You can make fun of yourself. You know, oh my gosh, I forgot about this. That was really dumb of me. Oh, wow. You know, you can laugh at yourself. People that struggle with this stuff, they can't laugh at themselves. Anything that makes a mistake, it makes them look bad. They feel bad. So they can't tolerate anyone finding out they made a mistake. You know, you get free from the stuff. You can be, oh, yeah, I made a mistake. Sorry. Sorry about that. Sorry, Pastor. Please forgive me. No biggie, no harm, no foul, you know. But boy, you don't declare for this stuff. And he's like, you gotta make sure that nobody knows that you're not perfect. So it's like, and then you got parents that are like that. And what I've seen is that when the parents get set free and healed from this, they can go to their children and apologize. And what does that do? The children are shocked, number one, but it turns their hearts back to their parents. And they're like, oh my gosh, now we have a healthy relationship. Now we can get together for the holidays and not dread it. We can love each other the way that the Lord intended us to be. So, it's all right. So everybody just close your eyes. And this is the fun part. This is where we see a lot of healings that happen. So, and just thank you, Heavenly Father, right now, that you want everyone healed from all emotional pains and traumas as well as all physical pains. That's what you want for us. And I've walked in that now. I see it in my own life. And it's amazing. It saves a lot of money. So I thank you, Father God, for that. And I just praise you, Lord, that you want all your people healed and set free. You want to come back with a pure and spotless bride. And we thank you, Father God, that when we're honest, truth be told, truth is being told, we can't fake you out. We can try and act that way in front of the church and other people. But it's a facade. And when we're honest, we're humble. When we humble ourselves, the enemy doesn't like it. Because then we can forgive people. And we can really mean it. And so I thank you, Father, right now. Just show everyone, all those people that have hurt them, and then show them from your perspective, the only reason those people ever did anything bad to them was because they were hurt. The enemy is the enemy. Not our mom, not our dad, not our husband, not our wife, not our kids. Not anybody. It's the enemy. The invisible enemy. The real invisible enemy. So we thank you, Father, Lord, for showing that tonight. So, with your whole heart, I want everyone to say, Heavenly Father, I choose to forgive
everyone
who has ever hurt me,
who has ever
lied about me, who's ever betrayed me, who's ever verbally abused me, who's ever sexually abused me. I give them to you, Lord, and I ask you to heal their soul wounds. And I thank you, Father, for dying on the cross. And being the model of forgiveness. And I ask you, Lord, to humble all pride out of me. I want to walk in humility.
I want to be
honest. And I repent for everyone that I've ever hurt. And I break off every curse that's ever been spoken over me from anyone in my bloodline and anyone that's outside my bloodline. I break it off in Jesus' name. And I also break off any witchcraft curses. And I want you to show me if I have anything in my possession
that has been cursed
so that I can get rid of it.
So that I can get rid of it.
I thank you, Lord.
I thank you, Lord.
For your truth. In Jesus' name, amen.
In Jesus' name, amen.
Now, I take authority. I'm going to pray this. I take authority in the name of Jesus. I command now all spirits to be gone from you in Jesus' name. Command spirits of Jezebel, spirits of Leviathan, spirits of Ahab, spirits of Legion, any and all witchcraft curses that have had any demonic spirits attached to you. I command them all to go in Jesus' name. I just say that you will never torment them ever again in Jesus' name. I thank you, Father God. Right now, we declare, Holy Father, that you will now allow the healing to take place in their bodies in Jesus' name. So first of all, we address the back. We command the backs to be aligned perfect in Jesus' name. We command the spines to be aligned perfect, Lord. And every disc come into perfect alignment. From the top of their C-curve to lower lumbar, we command all the discs to pop into perfect position now in Jesus' name. We thank you, Father, also that the hips will shift into perfect position in the name of Jesus. We thank you, Father, that any leg that is shorter than the other, we command it to grow out now to be the same length in Jesus' name. We command the arms and the shoulders and the necks to be healed in Jesus' name. We command full range of motion in all of their arms and their necks and their waists and their knees in the name of Jesus. Any and all accidents that happen, any car accidents, any football injuries, any sporting injuries, any falls, any traumas in their bodies, we command the cellular memory of those traumas to be gone and forgotten forever in Jesus' name. And we speak 100% health now and wholeness in the name of Jesus. We thank you, Father God, for childlike innocence now to be restored to them, Lord. Let them feel the purity and the righteousness and your holiness fall upon them in Jesus' name. We thank you, Father God, that they will laugh, Lord. They will laugh more than they'll cry ever, Lord, in Jesus' name. That they will have everything that was taken from them, that was stolen by the enemy, paid back now in Jesus' name. We thank you, Father God, for purification and cleansing our souls. We pray that they will sleep tonight soundly and solidly, Lord, and that they will have good dreams, that they will remember those dreams and have the interpretation given to them by the Holy Spirit in Jesus' name. We thank you, Father God, that they will never strive, because the servant of the Lord must not strive, but be gentle to all. 2 Timothy 2:23-24. We thank you, Father God, that you said that there's six things that you hate, seven that are an abomination. And the first thing, and this is Proverbs 6:16-19, is pride, a haughty look. We think that we'll never have another haughty look or pride anymore. We ask you, Lord, to allow us to walk in humility, Lord, just like you did. We thank you, Father God. Thank you, Lord Jesus, that we don't want to hear Matthew 7:21-23. Lord, Lord, look at all I've done for you. I've cast out demons in your name. I've prophesied in your name. Done wonders in your name. And you say, depart from me. We don't want that, Lord. We want our fruit to smell good. And we thank you, Father, that that's exactly what inner healing and deliverance does, is we come out of agreement with the enemy. We come into full agreement with you.
Yes.
And then we see the fruit, and it's awesome, and it's amazing. We also just declare, Heavenly Father, intimacy between couples. In fact, all those that are couples, I want you to face each other. All of you that are couples, you don't have to be married, but and I want you to hold each other's hands. And I want the men to look at the women. Let's look at the women, the back of the men. I want the men to say to the women, say, honey, I am sorry for everything that I have done to hurt you. And I want the women to say, I forgive you. And now I want the women to say to the husbands or the spouses or significant other friends, say, honey, I'm sorry for everything that I have done to hurt you. Will you forgive me? And I want the husbands to say, I forgive you. I now pronounce you man and wife. You may kiss. You may kiss your brides. So kiss and hug and love. Because the Lord wants to restore, you know, and it's a beautiful thing. You know, no one wants to be married and miserable. Nobody wants that. I don't think you do, so. And guess what? Nobody vomited. I've got a streak going here. Since 2015, not one person's vomited. I'm like, because, Lord, if anybody does that, I'm not doing this anymore. It's messy. It's disgusting. All right. Anyone feel lighter?
Yes.
A lot of you are going to feel lighter. Anyone feel stuff in your backs and stuff? Maybe move or shift into perfect positions. Isn't that cool? So cool. Anyone feel a leg that grew out or maybe? I had one person, in fact, it was in San Antonio, this person came into this kitchen, I was in the house, and he felt his leg was off by like an inch and a half, and it grew all the way out, and he could feel it. He was just standing there, he was like, oh my gosh, he couldn't believe it, then he could walk normal, and I'm like, yeah, that happens, so. And you may also notice that your vision gets cleared up, because oftentimes that spirit is a cloud of vision, so you'll see things more colorful. You'll see like blades of grass where you couldn't see them clearly before. So, okay, you can go ahead and sit down. I'm going to quickly go through the books that the Lord had me write. And then we'll have Doug come up here at the end. Restored to Freedom, this is my number one bestseller. And this book basically talks about Jezebel, Leviathan, Legion, and it has the prayers break off. So, if you know people that struggle, which we all do, this is a great resource to, here, read this book. and I don't say anything about Jezebel in anything on the outside, the inside of the table of contents. Until you get to, I think it's chapter 5. Then, because I end up talking about the wounds from the death, the moms, the sexual stuff, and then I get this, the characteristics and the physical stuff. So slowly, they are shown the truth so they can receive it. You can't just hit them and say, oh, you got the spirit of Jezebel. No, they will not like that. So, but if you can understand it, then they start to have the Holy Spirit slowly love on them and then prepare them. And then I've got the prayers to get deliverance. And I've seen, I don't know how many. We've got this also available in Spanish and German. Also available in Audible, which I'm the one that reads all my books. That wasn't fun to do. Because you know what? If you cough or sniff or do other bodily functions, it records it. And so you gotta like snap your fingers so you can see when you go back to make the change. And so I did all these all myself. And it was fun because I'm a tech guy. But anyway, this is Restored Freedom. And then the complement to that is Waking the Lion Within. This deals with the Ahab spirit. So a lot of people say, well, the Ahab spirit's not that bad. I'm like, yeah, it is. It said he did more evil in the sight of the Lord than all the other kings prior to him. And it says that a couple times in 1 Kings, 2 Kings. And there is one verse that says it's because his wife Jezebel stirred him up to do some of these things. But I'll say an example. Like the benefits that an Ahab will get with the person who struck with Jezebel is Ahab wanted Naboth's vineyard. He went to him, asked him, can I get it? Naboth said no. So then he's like, goes back and he pouts. Doesn't get what he really wants. So instead of just letting it go, he ends up pouting about it. He doesn't eat. So then Jezebel comes and says, why are you so sad? What's the matter? Well, we can't get Naboth's vineyard. You won't sell it to me. She's like, really? You're the king. Let me take care of that for you. Oh, really? Would you, Jezebel? Oh, you're the best. So what does Jezebel do? Jezebel then forms a letter, sends it in the name of the king to the people that are in charge of where Naboth lives, and they set him up. They're like, hey, come to this lovely banquet. We're going to have a roast. And you're going to be the person of the most interest that we're going to love on, you know. So he comes there, and they have two scoundrels which lie about him, accusing him of blaspheming God and coming against King Ahab. And they take him outside and stone him and kill him. And then Ahab gets what he wants. So typically, people struggle more than Jezebel's spirit will do the dirty work to get what they Ahab wants. And Ahab won't do that. So they work in tandem, you know. Whereas, Ahab's, oftentimes they can be, presidents of companies, they can be pastors, lots of pastors that have a good heart, but they tolerate things, and pastors can't tolerate. That's the hard thing, because they have a heart for people. You know, I get it, I love on people, but then the Jezebel spirit will try to get you to keep giving and giving and giving, and then guilt you, or try to manipulate you and say, come and do this for me. If you don't give me this position within the church, guess what, I'm going to lie about you. And then you're like, oh my gosh, I better give him that position. So you got to do the tough things that are hard to do. So, breaking the line with fear. Keep your peace on. This is interesting. I went for a walk one Friday night, and I had all 10 chapters given to me by the Lord. And I was done with the book by Monday. So it was like a four-day book. And It basically allows people to understand and discern at a deeper level when the enemy's trying to come in against you and steal your peace. It can be a myriad of things. It could be finances. It could be something that comes in the mail. It could be somebody driving their car too slow. It could be your spouse goes off on you. It could be the enemy, you know, it's oftentimes thoughts coming to you, which you can control the thoughts. When you go through and get healed and delivered, and you can take the thoughts captive much, much better. You don't get 50,000 thoughts a day. You and your partner get a couple thousand thoughts a day, and they're peaceful and they're good. But you can't control other people. But you can keep them at an arm's length so that you can limit and minimize that. Now, it's hard if they're married to them and they refuse to own it, which I've seen that a whole bunch. As I always say, if you're married to somebody, they refuse to own it. And the Lord said to me, is to give that person time to repent, like he talks about in Revelation 2, 18 through 23, about Jezebel, giving her time to repent. And if she wouldn't, then God says, I'll put her on a sickbed and I will kill her children. So he gets serious about that. So we give people time to repent, and if they won't, then the Lord offers them to say it's time to separate. I've seen more with women who are married to men that have Jezebel, that they start getting sick in their bodies, and they start to slowly die because of the constant verbal abuse. I had one woman that I knew personally that went to my church. Her husband seemed so sweet and so nice, but he wasn't. He was sexually molested by his dad. Nobody knew it, and he was abusing his wife and the kids. When the kids turned 18, they all left and had nothing to do with dad. And then his wife died of a tumor when she was like 42. And he got remarried. Within a year, the new wife started getting sick because of the constant verbal abuse behind closed doors. So, keep your peace on is a book. You walk in peace all the time, as much as you can. Again, you can't control other people, but you can sure try to protect yourself. Now, if you are in a relationship with someone that is hard to love, I got a book for you called Loving Like Christ, How to Love the Hard to Love People. So oftentimes the Lord does have you in a person's life that's very hard to love. So it gives you a perspective from the Lord of a lot of people in the Bible that went through this, and how to love them and see them through Christ's eyes without dying. And I'll say this, if you're in a relationship with someone, if you're married to someone that has Jezebel narcissism, it wants to stop you from doing anything for the Lord. That's its assignment. And so that's why it's challenging. There's a lot of people that are wanting to separate God, they can't because that spirit is operating in their spouse. So, but you might be there for a season to love them through some things. You might have a relationship with someone as a friend, but you need to have discernment as to how much to be involved in their life. So, Jesus loves to heal through you. He talks about walking in health from the Lord. And again, since 2009, I've been healed from everything. I haven't taken Tylenol, ibuprofen, vitamins, nothing. I haven't spent anything on health insurance. That went away in 2012 because it went away with my job when the Lord was transitioning me into ministry. So, and I have pictures in this book. So I have pictures of my son before and after, which is really good. And then, let's see, who wants to marry Jezebel?
Right.
Who wants to marry Jezebel? So this book I wrote because I learned that there's a lot of people out there that will call themselves Christians, and they will act very nice and sweet until they can get you to say I do. And as soon as you say I do, they become a different person. They trigger into someone they're not normally. And they know they have to be nice in order to get you to say I do. Because if anybody treats you badly in your dating, so they're always going to have their best behavior, but there's some things to look for. And the longer you can draw it out, they normally can't be nice for more than a year.
Right.
Tends not to. So they'll manifest. They'll get selfish, they'll say something, and then you're like, okay, that doesn't sound nice. But if they can get you married in 3 months, they can be nice enough for that short period of time. So, you know, it's a good book for people that are looking to get married. Keep your faith on and give out examples for health, for going to court without an attorney against Jezebels. I got some experience with that.
Wow.
I can trust the Lord to be your attorney. And that's not easy because they're really good at lying. and I've dealt, I've actually worked with judges and talked to them about these spirits. And they're like, oh yeah, we see this a lot. You know, they're like, One of them recently just said, every college in America needs to read these books. They need to be required reading. Because it would open up so many eyes and help so many people get healed. But I said, everybody in prisons need to read these. You know, get delivered by forgiving. Because that's the reason that they're struggling. Pure and spotless talks about what it really truly means to be a Christian in every aspect, and how the fruit of the Spirit works, and not just act. Because you can't act if you're waiting to heaven. You know, God knows what your heart is and what your mind is. And if you're not healed yet, delivered, then you're going to have a lot of fruit of the flesh that can be the reason why you don't get to heaven. You know, if you have a lot of pride, you have a lot of people that are prideful. God, Lucifer kicked out of heaven. So it can keep you from going to heaven as well. A lot of prideful, arrogant, and God hates pride. Over and over, it says he hates that. So. And then people that want to get certified under my ministry to actually help pay back the enemy and do this yourself, it's been a great thing that's happened. So we've got 150 people in 9 countries now that are certified. And they are paying back the enemy now. So with that experience, either they had gone through being struggling with Jezebel or Ahab. And to get certified, you need to watch 4 videos on YouTube, and then you need to read these 2 books, Waking the Lion Within and Restored to Freedom, and that book, School of Ministry. So these are $10 each for the book, or you can get 7 for $60. Normally, they're $13 on Amazon plus shipping, so you can get them a lot cheaper here. You can get all 9 books for $75 if you want. And you can, I think, credit card, debit card, checks, or cash. That is it. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to step back to my book table in the back. We'll take care of any book orders, and then if anyone wants some personal prayer after that, then we'll do personal prayer. So I'll have Doug come up, and I work on a free will offering. So thank you for coming tonight, and I hope this was life-changing and marriage-saving, because that is my heart, is to save people from strife and fighting and arguing and get healed as well. So.
Thank you.
Yeah. We're going to take back Nelson's study.